thank you for coming. This is the September brown bag session for city employees. And this is National Preparedness Month. So September every year is National Preparedness Month. And it's a really good opportunity for a lot of reminders to do things maybe we haven't done before, or review the things we have done and just make sure everything's fresh and up to date. The other thing is oftentimes you might see emails or sales from stores that are out there to pick up some of these supplies that you might need tax-free or at discounted price. So just keep your eyes open for those things. But what we're going to talk about today is just some really good kind of high-level reminders about preparedness and things to look at for ourselves. So you do have in front of you the weather alert radios. Congratulations that you received those. This will help you should there be an incident, a weather-related incident. This weather radio will go off and alert you. So you want to have it in a location that can access the signals as well as alert you appropriately, you know, as you go through that. And then you have some handouts to refer to and help yourselves prepare you and your family, your community, your office, things like that. So emergency preparedness. Really, we conduct and do emergency preparedness, and not only for businesses and communities, but for ourselves individually, because it can range, an emergency can range from lots of things that can be really just inconvenient for us individually to really drastic and dramatic as a whole for our entire community and for the city itself. So we just want to make sure that we are able to minimize the impacts that an emergency can have on us, or that should we be impacted, that we're prepared to do something about it and that our families are prepared to do something about it. So those are some of the things you want to look at. Again, September is National Preparedness Month. It is a nationwide effort, which means the Department of Homeland Security, FEMA, does a campaign every year, and this is the month where they push a lot of the preparedness issues, and they have ready.gov. It's a great website, great resource. And then the City of Fairfax has obviously our own website, an emergency management website that talks to us about terrorism events, active shooter events, any natural hazards that we might need to prepare for. So everything we talk about today and everything you have in front of you is applicable to those things, as well as terrorism, you know, things we don't want to think about that could happen to us, criminal activity, active shooter types of things. So let's make sure we have all of our preparedness done. It's one of the best things we can do. And we work as partners, not only with just our community here within City of Fairfax, but with our federal partners, as well as the state, non-governmental organizations, faith-based organizations, volunteer groups. Again, it's a whole community approach to make sure that we're prepared for anything that could happen. So there's really four big steps we want to make sure that we rely on when it comes to our preparedness. We want to make a kit or get a kit. And we'll talk about some few areas to get a kit, where to put those kits. The other thing is to make a plan. Have a plan for yourself. Have a plan for your family. Have a plan for here at work. Understand what the plans are for you, if you have kids, if you have other family members who are at different businesses, schools, universities, daycare, things like that. Understand what those things are. How to really be informed, how to get information the right way. And one step is that weather alert radio, which is great. And then also to get involved. One way is to be here at these presentations, absolutely. So thank you for coming and listening to these. Another way we'll talk about is volunteering opportunities. So we'll talk about that a little bit. So when we talk about an emergency supply kit, really what we're talking about are things that you might need or your family might need for about 72 hours, if not a little bit more, if you're able to do a little bit more. But we recommend at least 3 days worth of food, water, and supplies that can include medications, clothing, money. Because if we're involved in an incident where we don't have life safety issues, our first responders aren't necessarily going to be able to get to us quickly, because they're working active fires, active life safety incidents, trying to help the incident stabilize. And so if we're not in need, we need to be able to take care of ourselves. And that means knowing how to shut off our own utilities, gas, water, electricity perhaps, you know, breakers and things like that. So part of our kit, we need to make sure that we have supplies for our family, for our pets. If we have pets, we want to take care of them as well. And we want to look at least 2 kits. Having one for the home, you can have a bigger kit if you're going to be staying there, sheltering in place. You can have a smaller kit if you need to grab and go. You can also have a kit in your vehicle. We oftentimes recommend this, especially for us here where we have seasons. Either it's hot or really, really cold. That's typically when we have it. In case our car or vehicle gets broken down, We have flares, we have blankets, we have coats, gloves, extra heavy coats if we have to go out there. So that's really important. The other thing we can do is have emergency kits at our office. Oftentimes us as ladies, we wear heels, or maybe we're not in the right types of shoes, so having just a pair of sneakers and socks with maybe a couple extra items that you might need to grab and go in case there's debris that we have to walk on. We don't want to obviously become injured, hurt ourselves, or put ourselves at risk. So those are some of the kits that we can have. Now, the things we should put in those kits, definitely food and water. So you want non-perishable types of foods. Know what those expiration dates are, because things do expire, and look at them on a regular basis. This is why 1 month out of the year focused on preparedness is so great. It's kind of the opportunity we can look at to refresh those supplies, see that we have those expiration dates known, and if we need to pull things out. So you want to have things that don't necessarily require refrigeration or cooking or any water for preparation. You can also look at granola bars, simple snack things. I also highly recommend not only a manual can opener, but put food in that you like to eat. So if you're not a person who regularly likes to eat granola bars, but you prefer a different kind of bar, put that in as well. Because oftentimes when we're forced to eat stuff, that's when we really don't want it. You know, I've been on a diet before. I love salads. I do. They're wonderful. Except when you tell me that's the only thing I can eat, then it's the worst thing ever, right? So if we're in a situation where we have to shelter in place for a few days or even a day, and that's kind of the only food that we can eat, we want to make sure we enjoy it. So little things like that. And then water. We want to make sure we have at least 1 gallon of water per day, per person, and per pet. That's a minimum. And then if you have people at your house, family who are with you that have other types of needs for water, then you want to obviously have extra water for that. But at least 1 gallon of water per person, per day, and per pet, so that we can stay adequately hydrated. Make sure that they're stored in a clean, dry place. You can oftentimes get the big gallons of water that you can put, you know, in a big dispenser, and those can just go off to the side and you have plenty of water right there. Takes up less space than trying to get a whole bunch of gallons. And depending on the type of area you live in or the climate, that might also indicate how much water you might need. You might need a little bit more, probably not less, but you definitely might need a little bit more if it's hot. You also want to have these radios are great for having in those kits. So if you have it in an accessible area where you're listening to it and then you have to shelter in place, you can either take that with you, or if you have to go somewhere, you can take that with you. Make sure you have extra batteries. Don't want to run out of batteries for that. As well as a flashlight. Definitely have a flashlight. Even those glow sticks that you can crack so you can have some light like that, but extra batteries for those things. I also recommend having a spare charger, you know, those chargers that you can do for phones or computers. It's an extra pack. That's something good to have as well, so you can get that little extra charge. Always keep a car charger with you, so if you don't have an electrical outlet, you can at least try to charge in your vehicle a phone or something of that sort. First aid kit, basic first aid kit is perfect to have on hand. Some Band-Aids, some gauze, some antiseptic, maybe some tweezers. A lot of them are sold with silver blankets. They're about this big usually in a packet. You know, they're a small square, and you unwrap them and they help conserve heat nicely. So if somebody's in shock or if you experience something, you're out in the cold, you can use that. So a little easy, you know, first aid kit you can find at one of these big box stores that are out there would be perfect. A whistle. If you're under debris or in debris or trapped, you can at least use the whistle. A little bit of air goes a long way with a whistle versus trying to yell over material, equipment being used, things like that. And then even a wrench or pliers or whatever type of tool you might need to shut off your utilities. And then also make sure that in this kit that we have appropriate items for our unique family needs. So if we have family members who might have some disabilities, or maybe there's some access or functional needs, medication type needs, visibility issues, hearing issues, that we just make sure we appropriately account for that within our family kit. So that includes prescription medications, prescription glasses, maybe have a few extra pairs. My husband just stepped on one of his pears because the cat knocked it off the table today or yesterday, and he saw it, he walked by it, no problem, and then on the third time he forgot they were there and stepped on it in literally a minute time. So I was waiting for that to happen. Fortunately, they were, you know, like a $2 cheater's pear. But just have extras because you never know what might happen for that. Any family documents? That's really important. At one of our other brown bag sessions, and also in front of you, we talked about developing a family disaster plan. And it helps you put down a lot of really great information on, you know, who's in your family, special banking information. You want to keep this secure, but things that you would need to know. There's also what's called the Emergency Financial First Aid Kit, the EFAC, that can accompany this document. And this really helps you identify financial or important documents to keep on hand. And these are things you can put in your kit or keep with you. Things such as mortgage papers, things such as insurance papers. And you want to have doctor information or prescription information, a copy of your prescriptions. So that's really great information to keep with you in your kit. Any formula or diapers for infants or any adult needs that are things like that that people may have. And then especially games or toys to entertain, not just children and not just your pets, but also yourself. You know, oftentimes playing a nice game with your family, even at a time where if you're in the middle of an emergency, might be relaxing and help everyone calm down. So you want to think about some of those things. For a list of additional items, definitely go to fairfaxva.gov and go to emergency management. There's going to be lists, and that'll help direct you to a lot of other places, as well as ready.gov. So in our pet supplies, some of the same things apply for us, but you also want to make sure not only food and water, if they have medication or medical records, but have a picture. Have a picture of your pet. Have a picture of you with your pet. So you can say, yes, this is in fact my pet. Have a photocopy of their license or their tag, because if they're lost, you may not have that information, so you'll want it. It'll also be beneficial if they're chipped, and if they're not, please go get them chipped, microchipped. But you can have their microchip information on hand, as well as they usually have websites now, and you can update the information for your pets for that. You're definitely going to need a harness or a leash. Make sure it's one they're used to, not something brand new that they've never used before. My dog uses a collar. A couple of times I've put him in a regular harness, and he can walk just fine on that, but we just usually use the collar for our walks because we don't go very far with him. He goes and plays off the leash other times. So that's what we would use. We would use a collar. He's used to that. Make sure you have an appropriate size crate for your animals, not only to transport, but for them to stay in and that they're comfortable in it, because you may have to go somewhere that they're not able to move around freely. So you want to make sure that they're comfortable in whatever little home, little office space they're going to have at that point. And then familiar bedding or toys, treats. The other thing to remember, they're going to be scared. They can feel in the air, right? They know when something's going on. And so just to take that extra time to make them feel comfortable. One recommendation is just to maybe keep your animals separate for a little while. They may always get along. I have cats and a dog. They may always get along, but when stress levels are higher, then they might, you know, interact with each other differently. So just for their own safety, and just make sure to watch them around other people that they're not used to. First responders, you know, give them some idea that there's, you know, an animal here, and try to help with that. So once we've done our kit and we have that together, we can definitely have a family emergency plan. It's not a sequential type of thing, but we want to make sure we have all these things in place. So putting a family plan together, a family emergency plan, really means that we as a family or as a community, so you with your friends, with your neighbors, with your coworkers, understand what you should be doing or your family should be doing if there's an emergency. And oftentimes, emergencies don't happen in beautiful weather at the right time when we're all together, hanging out, ready for it to happen. It usually happens either in the middle of the night or when we're all in five different places. Somebody's at the shopping center, somebody's at school, somebody's at work, and something has happened and now we can't get a hold of each other and we don't know where to go and how to meet up. And that's really the point. So we know what we should be doing should something happen. So when we talk about making a family plan, sit down and talk to your family about it. Here's what we should do. If we're all at home and we need to get out of the house, here are the few places we should evacuate to and talk to them about that and make those plans. And again, going to the City of Fairfax website and also looking at the documents you have in front of you to make a plan helps walk you through the little maps you can draw, little diagrams, what should be included in your family plan so you can talk about those things. And make sure that you take into consideration where you live, the neighbors you might have, if you have pets, things like that. Just need to consider all of those variables that you could come across. Okay. Make sure you plan in advance how to get in touch with each other. And oftentimes, it's easier to call outside of the area to a contact who lives maybe in a different county or even a different state. And so if you all call that person, well, then they have the information that they can relay back and forth. During emergencies, obviously, the cell towers get very congested. If you have a landline, it makes it a lot easier. Okay, so having an idea about who to call or even where to meet up is going to be really important. And again, the city has a template that you can get started with, and then you also have items in front of you for that. So some of the elements to think about, we talked about the out-of-town contact. Identify the school, if you have children going to a school or to a camp, or even at your workplace. What work plans do you have in place? Should something happen, do you have special release procedures? Are they going to shelter people in place at a location and not allow them to be picked up or leave, or they will? Things like that. Identify at least two meeting places, one in the neighborhood, one outside the neighborhood when it comes to your home and your family. And then if you have older folks who live with you, parents, uncles, aunts, whomever it might be, or anyone who might have a disability or an access or functional need or young children, make sure that our plans also take those things into consideration. It may seem pretty obvious and straightforward, but sometimes we don't really think that once we get out of our house, the rest of the neighborhood may not be accessible if we have mobility issues or have a mobility device with us, things like that. And then definitely plan for your pets. Plan with your neighbors, because if you're not home and if you have a neighbor who maybe stays home and might be able to access your pets if there's an issue and help evacuate them out, go ahead and consider doing that and coming together as a community, as a neighborhood, to help each other. Sometimes we may have to make a very hard decision, or somebody may be making it for us, to either stay, meaning we might have to shelter in place, or go evacuate. You know, governments, especially the City of Fairfax, do not take an evacuation order lightly, if that ever has to be issued, or the state government, the Commonwealth of Virginia. They don't take that lightly. So my recommendation is, if folks are saying you need to evacuate, heed to it, get out. There's a reason for it. They know what's coming, or they see some issues that might present dangers to you. So if you have to go, go. But you have these plans in place. You've already planned for these things. You've identified areas for you to go, okay? In other situations, you might wanna stay. If there's air quality issues, if there's too much debris for you to move around, snow, we experience that a lot when we get really bad blizzards. You just can't go anywhere, okay? Nor should you. It's too dangerous out there. So again, you want to have those go kits in place, those plans in place on what to do. So if you do have to evacuate, plan where you're going to go. You choose several destinations, maybe in a couple different directions. Plan your driving routes. Have those maps with you. Have those physical maps with you in your kit. I remember when I was younger, my father, he was an insurance agent, and we'd go to commercial properties to do the pictures and insuring of things. And I was little, I was 5 or 6, and he'd give me the map book, the Thomas Brothers map book. He'd give me the address. He said, okay, get me there. I had to learn how to find the address, how to use a map, how to tell him how to get there. Nowadays, we just use our phone, right? Google Maps or MapQuest. But if I don't have a phone anymore, will I know what to do and how to do it? So you want to have those hard copy things with you to make sure you know where you might be going, especially if it's out of the area and familiar area where you're going to. If you don't have a car, your car might be disabled. Identify maybe what some of those public transportation routes might be that you can use. Take that supply kit, that emergency supply kit, that little one maybe that you have, or if you can throw something in the car, take to a hotel with you, throw that in. Usually, you can have one of those Tupperware bins or Rubbermaid bins, put all that stuff in and off it goes into the car. It's pretty easy. Lock your door Don't forget to lock your door and your windows when you leave. And take your pets, please. I know that sounds obvious, but not everyone thinks about that. They'll be fine. Well, you may not return for a week or two. And now you have a little loved one at home who doesn't have food or water. Or the ability to go out to use the restroom. So please take your pets with you and identify pet-friendly lodging locations. And then the city will also look at, or other jurisdictions will look at, pet-friendly shelters if that's needed. So we also want to remain informed. Be informed. Learn about the different types of emergencies and what appropriate responses would be for us in this area. Okay? So we want to make sure that we know what might happen here. What could we anticipate from terrorism to natural disasters? Okay. And then which emergencies are more likely to affect us? That will also indicate maybe where you start your prioritization of what you plan and prepare for. And then take a look at what the emergency plans are in your community. Snow, we experience that a lot. Do we know the snow routes? Do we know what areas we can or can't go to or should be going to? And then get involved. We have a lot of opportunities in the community to get involved. One is a Citizens Academy for the fire department. So it's the Fire Academy. We also have the Volunteers in Policing program. You can go do that. You can also be a part of the CERT program, the Community Emergency Response Team. Or you can volunteer for emergency drills, emergency exercise, not only within the city of Fairfax, but also out with other jurisdictions that have them. They need role players to help them practice and prepare. So those are some really great ways to get involved. Again, you can go to ready.gov. You can also go to fairfaxva.gov to get more information about putting all these things together, especially during Preparedness Month. It's a great month to do it. That's all from me. Hopefully that touched upon some good items, good reminders. You have some great resources available to you, both here in person and also online, to really help you get started. Thank you so much. Have a great day.